It gives me immense pleasure on behalf of the Board of Trustees and the Board of Directors of Chennai International Centre to welcome you all for this event. Can I request the people on the top to settle down soon? Thank you. The event goes on like this. First, I will invite Gopal. Gopal will take us through the journey of what CIC is all about. And after that, we have a small talk by Dr. Rangarajan of the Madras School of Economics. And later, we'll have the speaker of the session, Mr. Nandan Nilekani. Over to you, Gopal.
Good evening, and it's great to see all of you here. So many friends, so many well-wishers, and so many people from every slice of Chennai community. So welcome to the inauguration of the new child of Chennai, the Chennai International Centre. Of course, to be blessed by the gods is always a good thing. So we always saw today's showers just in time to welcome us, but stop just in time to allow us to come here very comfortably. So that is a very good sign. So now let me get on to what is Chennai International Centre for a second. New Delhi is, of course, the nation's capital. Mumbai is a financial capital. Calcutta likes to think of itself as a cultural capital. But Madras, that is now Chennai, we think is a country's intellectual capital. Now, before you think that we are foisting this claim on Chennai, this was actually attributed to the former Prime Minister of India, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, who actually said that in 1952 publicly. He said Madras is the great intellectual capital. Of course, he meant the Madras presidency, but we have been a little liberal in borrowing it for the city of Chennai. Now, looking back in history, since this is all about ideas and achievement coming together, we are at the crossroads of ideas and achievement, we wondered who we take as exemplars for the city, who exhibit this wonderful quality. Clearly, 2000 years ago, the Saint poet Thiruvalluvar is the first example. Some people think he came from other places, but it's okay. Chennai welcomes everybody. We welcome him to be part of Chennai. Of course, the noted philosopher and theologian Sri Ramanuja, 1000 years ago, was a great achiever with great ideas from the city of Chennai. And more recently, 100 years ago, we had, of course, the divine nightingale singer, Srimati M.S. Subbalakshmi. So we've had many achievers in Chennai. In fact, when you look back, there's a whole host of them that you can look at. It's one city that accounts for 3 of the 8 winners of the Nobel Prize, not to mention 3 presidents. So it's a city of achievement. Civilizations, of course, started on the banks of rivers, but cities with a networked ecosystem are now the new hotspots for intellectuals and intellectual growth. Chennai, of course, has many institutions, many individuals, and many businesses which contribute to this. But the question really to us when we started this was saying, are we doing enough to hold on to the advantage that Chennai has? There is, of course, evidence of so much of thought leadership, and I see many of the thought leaders with us today. But the unhappy truth, to be very candid, is that what started many, many centuries and decades ago seems to be slowing down. In fact, we see here of more about Chennai's ideas and achievers succeeding in other places like Indira Nooyi or Sundar Pichai, for example. There are many good industry associations here also, which espouse their own agenda, and societies like the YPO who congregate people for fellowship and learning. So when we thought about the issue of achievement, ideas, we thought Chennai needed a platform that can bring people together to discuss ideas from achievers and get inspired, and perhaps in that process to stimulate and revive this great intellectual hotspot of the country, in fact of Asia. So a group of us got together, very appropriately we got together 1 year ago on Chennai Day in the Fort St. George in Robert Clive's house, in the ballroom actually, and that's us. And that's a charter that we signed. And we were told this was the only thing he was unable to take back on the ship with him. Everything else is gone. So we sat there and we came up with this idea and we worked for a year. Fortunately, we were blessed with the support of an eminent group of people, eminent group of patrons, many of whom are here. I see Dr. Rangarajan, I see Mr. Raghavan, I see Mr. Gopal Swami, I see Mr. M.K. Narayan, I see Mrs. Sudharani Raghupati. I hope I'm not missing many others who've come here. But we were supported by so many people who came forward and said, we are happy. And we told them, you are exemplars. You are the people whom Chennai exemplifies and celebrates as successes. So they came together with about 10 or 11 of us from very different swaths of society, manufacturing companies, IT companies, newspapers, builders, movie theater operators, private equity people, and put this idea together with three thoughts in mind. The first thought is, may the best ideas resound everywhere on this neutral platform. And who could we have better than Mr. Nandan Nilekani, coming from Bangalore, who is the idea man of India. But the reason we invited him and were delighted that he accepted was that he's not just an idea man, but he also represents achievement. And he's going to talk about that, so you know about that. But this crossroads of ideas and achievement is what we want to celebrate here. Not just ideas, not just achievers, but achievers with ideas. And that's what we think Chennai International Center really stands for. The word international, why? Everybody asks us. We think because it represents when India International Center started, which is the progenitor of all international centers in India. And we are actually helped a lot here by Ravichandar, and he's somewhere in this room, from the Bangalore International Center, who in some sense brought the good news from Bangalore to Chennai. But we like to remind Ravi that both he and his wife have been lent to Bangalore by Chennai. So please don't forget that. So when they brought us this good news and we started, we also felt that international today meant a two-way flow, not just a singular flow. In Delhi, they said getting international ideas in. What we are saying is getting them in, but also celebrating them by letting them go. And lastly, our hope and our vision for the long term is like the India International Center. Today, we've been very fortunate to be hosted. Dr. Rangarajan, thank you. Sundar, thank you for hosting us at this wonderful place, Madras School of Economics. But we hope in the long term, we might aspire to work with our friends like Madras School of Economics and perhaps create a small center where people can come, and that center can actually be a spa for the mind and for the soul. So, like Plutarch said, the mind is not a vessel to be filled, but a fire to be kindled. Today, we hope to start that fire today by kindling your imagination with Nandan's thoughts and Nandan's ideas. Each of you here are achievers, and we are delighted to have all of you here. You're special to us because you've done something for Chennai in your own way. When I meet everybody in the corridor, that's what is going through my mind. We hope to achieve more achievers as we go along. Thank you for being here. The center is now open to your ideas and how they can be achieved. Thank you.
Thank you, Gopal, for that. Excellent exposition of what exactly the thought process behind the Chennai International Center. This center wouldn't have been possible in terms of the first speech which we are talking about unless we had the support of Dr. Rangarajan and his Madras School of Economics. The indulgence we have from MSc is overwhelming. We are truly honored. We look forward for hearing Dr. Rangarajan on the partnership which CIC is having with CIC, with MSc going forward. Could I request you, sir? Thank you.
Mr. Gopal Srinivasan, Mr. Nandan Nilekani, and friends, it gives me a great pleasure to be with you all this evening at the very first public function of the Chennai International Center. The Madras School of Economics is very happy to be associated with this new initiative. We in Madras School of Economics are willing to offer all the infrastructure facilities that may be needed by the new center in terms of organizing lectures, conferences, and seminars. The center, the CIC, is meeting a felt need of the city. It is our hope that the Chennai International Center will emerge as a vibrant intellectual center of this city. There are many issues that need to be discussed, issues that confront the society. In a democracy, it is very often said that the three pillars are the executive, the legislature, and the judiciary. Later on, people thought that the press is also important, and that is why it came to be called the fourth estate. But truly speaking, there are many pillars to democracy. If informed public opinion is a basis of democracy, then all institutions which work towards that end are really integral part of democracy. And that is the way in which we have to view the emergence of the Chennai International Center. It's very often said, democracy is a system of government where governance is with the consent of the governed. If that is to be so, then the public opinion should be based upon adequate information, correct information, and debate. And that is where institutions like CIC come in. We really need to create a situation in which debates, important issues are debated, and that leads to the formation of appropriate opinion. As I said, it is our intention to help or to associate ourselves with the center in whatever way it wants. But ultimately, all of us should contribute towards creating a really a vibrant intellectual center as CIC. True, you need a place, but until you get the place, you have another place here. So you can wait. You need not be in a hurry, but maybe at some particular point you need a building, because that itself creates a certain ambience. In fact, most of the people who come to India International Center come not only to listen to the lectures, but also to have tea and coffee and chat about. So that is also part of the intellectual exercise. So let me therefore welcome the creation of this new institution, and we are happy that we also have some role in contributing towards its emergence. We are happy that Nandan Nilekani is kicking off, or if that's not a good word, flagging off the new institution with his lecture. Nandan, as an active mind exploring new frontiers always, he is an inspiring example to new generation. I welcome him to Madras School of Economics and to the center. So, greeting to Chennai International Center and welcome from MSC. Thank you.
Thank you, Doctor, for the words of wisdom. We recognize R. Thyagarajan, our patron, also available here. Sorry, sir, I think Gopal missed mentioning your name. Sorry for that. Well, I'm a real estate guy, so first thing what we did was found the best location. So we requested Venu. Venu could use his good offices and we could manage to get MSC. Thank you, sir. Thank you for asking us to be here for some more time till we get our place. It's very heartening that we have with us Padma Bhushan Nandan Nilekani as the first speaker of the event. Ravi, I think I should tell you that initially when you said that there may not be many people coming for this event, we assured you that the hall will be full. So today we don't have space. I think people are standing and we had to turn them out. So we look forward to hearing from Nandan. Now, Nandan needs no introduction. Everyone knows that he is the co-founder of Infosys, and also he is the drive behind UIDA, the unique identification number, the Aadhaar card, which is popularly known. But aside that, he has something different. He's a co-founder of an initiative called the Egg Step. It's a foundation, it's an e-learning foundation which they have started, wherein they're looking for connecting the underprivileged, and in the education field, some initiative has been taken up. I welcome you, Nandan. Please go ahead and give your presentation. Thank you.
So it's great to be here for the inaugural session of the Chennai International Center, and I'm delighted to be here. Thanks, Gopal, Venu, all of you, Dr. Rangarajan. I'm going to say things that Dr. Rangarajan is not going to agree with, so I just want to warn you. So I thought this could be a session to just provoke some thinking, and you don't have to believe or agree with what I'm saying, but it's just a way to think about the future, and I just want to sort of take up some commonly accepted ideas and say maybe they may not be the way things go. So that's why I've called this presentation as an alternate view of the future and India in the age of technological disruption, because I think the technological disruption is happening in every business, every government action, and so I'm just trying to put a theory forward. Now, what's the general belief? How do we move forward? Believe that if you really want to achieve economic growth and put people out of poverty, you need to do a lot of exports. So export-led growth. Exports was the way Japan became a modern nation. Exports was the way South Korea became a modern nation. And exports was the way that China took the largest number of people out of poverty. So clearly, that model is something which we all understand. The second thing is that it should be led by manufacturing. That you need to move people from agriculture into manufacturing, create lots of jobs, manufacturing jobs, start manufacturing at the low end of the food chain and become more and more sophisticated. And that again is a model that happened in Japan, South Korea, and China. And the final thing is that this is done by large employers creating lots of jobs. In other words, you have gigantic factories with thousands and thousands of employees, and promoting that is going to create jobs. So that's a broad implicit model of growth that we see. But I believe that actually, because of what's happening today, because of many things happening both externally and internally, maybe there's a different way to look at things. And my thesis is that the growth hereon will be led more by domestic consumption than exports. And I'll give my arguments as to why I believe that is so. It will actually be led by services and not so much by manufacturing. And again, I'll argue why I think so. And finally, it's going to be led by thousands and millions of small businesses and not a few large firms. So these are the three tenets of my argument. A lot of this is happening because of a very important thing which has never happened before, which is the digitization of the Indian economy. The mobile phone is the world's first universal product. It's something which everybody has. India is not lagging behind, and India has more than 1 billion mobile phones. And it's really the one thing everybody has. That's a new thing which is happening, that mobile phones is now the first universal product on the planet. 5.2 billion mobile people have a mobile phone. But within the mobile phones, there's another mega trend, which is not just the feature phones of old, but smartphones. And today, smartphones in India are growing at the rate of 25 million a quarter, 100 million a year. We already have something like 200 million smartphones. and we expect at current growth rates about 600 to 700 million smartphones by 2020. Now, there's some things that distinguish the smartphone from the feature phone. The first is that it now allows you to have applications that are delivered directly to your phone without asking the permission of the telecom provider that you have. And that's what this whole debate about net neutrality is: how do you make sure the internet is available to anybody to deliver an application to you without taking permission from the service provider? And that's the whole fight in this whole net neutrality. The second thing is that the smartphone, because it has an operating system, you know, in some cases most of it is the Android operating system from Google, and there's Apple iOS, generates a lot more data about what's happening than the feature phone did, right? In the feature phone, basically you had SMS and a couple of things, but in the smartphone you have everything. You know where it is because the phone has a GPS. You can make out how the phone is being moved because the phone has a gyroscope. So there's lots and lots of stuff. So it's basically just generating data much more than anything ever before. That's important as we go forward. And also the smartphone can be used offline. A feature phone could not be used offline. You had to be always connected. But a smartphone today, many people in India use smartphone as an offline device to watch video. In other words, they'll be using a smartphone in a village. There's no connectivity, but they'll be watching, Kabali or whatever. Maybe trailer. These three properties, the fact that it's over the top, so there's no control by the operator, the fact that it generates a lot of data, and the fact that it's an offline device, and the offline internet is very popular in India, I think that makes it very different from the old revolution. And we're looking at something like 700 million smartphones by 2020. The third thing is, of course, that along with that, internet penetration is going up. So we already have 331 million internet users. And there's this very famous analyst called Mary Meeker, who does her annual State of the Internet report, which comes out around May, June. She works with Kleiner Perkins. And she says the only bright spot in the internet world is India. Because all other markets are now saturated, they've hit the peak, but India is still going to grow because all these people who are getting smartphones are also getting onto the internet. And now we have Wi-Fi hotspots coming up, we have Reliance Jio coming up. So internet penetration is going to be quite ubiquitous in the coming years. And internet is not just something used by elite kids to play Pokemon. It's also used across the country for the police are using for crime scenes, somebody is selling products, somebody has using it to sell his agricultural produce, somebody is using a bank account. This is a group called, did a digital dish. They actually went from village to small town to small town and looking at internet usage. And what they found was there was remarkable usage of the internet all over the country in very, very innovative ways. So it's not just an elite product. It's something that's used by everyone. And then, of course, there's the Aadhaar platform, which we built. The Aadhaar is now at 1.3 or 1.4 billion people today have an Aadhaar, and that was done within 5.5 years. And there are more than a billion people who have Aadhaar now. And what's important to understand is that there are very few billion user platforms in the world. By platform having a billion users, that more than a billion people who use a particular thing, and they're all in the United States. There are about 12 of them in the US. And they're all owned by private companies. So Google has 7. Android, Chrome, YouTube, Search, whatever. Microsoft has 2, Office and Windows. And then you have Facebook, which has 3, which is Facebook, Facebook Messenger, and WhatsApp. So fundamentally, in a world where US companies dominate these billion user platforms, the only billion user platform outside the US is Aadhaar. Even the Chinese platforms like WeChat are at about 900 million. It's the only platform built by a government. All the others are in the private sector. It was built faster than anything else in 5.5 years. So fundamentally, it's there. But what's important is not just the fact that there are a billion users. these billion users can be authenticated online. In other words, I can use a biometric authentication using a device and confirm that the person there is the person he claims to be. And this is a feature which is being used right now across the country for all kinds of applications. The application which has been made most famous by a prime minister is a biometric attendance for bureaucrats. So they all check in the morning and check out in the night, and it's one of the reasons I left Delhi. I didn't want to get beaten up. So that's the Aadhaar, a billion users. And now this authentication is becoming part of the standard phone. So when we designed this 7 years back, that technology was not there. But today I can integrate an Aadhaar authentication into a phone. And the first of such devices has already come out, which is a device from Samsung, which has an iris camera. If you look at that back of that tablet, there's a regular camera in the middle. In the top left-hand corner is an iris camera. And I can just look and click and do an authentication in real time. So now with the phone having the authentication, it becomes very, very simple to verify. Now this is a tablet, but in the next 6 months, there'll be smartphones coming with this as a standard feature. They'll either use the fingerprint or the iris for authentication. So these are all, you know, fundamentally different things that are going to come in a big way. At the same time, this government has been very, 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 very focused on banking and financial inclusion. And something like 22.6 crore accounts have been opened, about 226 million bank accounts. And I think it's fair to say that everybody will have a bank account in the company. At least every adult will have a bank account fairly soon. And what's important is that, again, this is a revolution started by Dr. Rangarajan. Dr. Rangarajan, when he was RBI governor, came out with the two seminal reports on computerization in the banking system, Rangarajan 1, Rangarajan 2 reports. And today that tradition is being continued. So it started all this. And in the last few years, a lot of the banking system is getting completely digitized. It's becoming digital. And you have, like for example, wallets. Everybody now uses Paytm Karo and all that. So you use Paytm to pay. You have payment banks. Dr. Rangarajan came up with the concept of payment bank, and many people got the license. And something which is going to go live on the 31st of first, which is called as the Unified Payment Interface. And about 10 to 15 banks are going to go live within 3 to 4 days, which allow you to pay from any mobile phone to any mobile phone with one click. It's going to be as simple as sending or receiving an email to be able to do payments. It's the most advanced interoperable payment system in the world. And one more thing which is going to come in the next 6 months to a year is something called the Bharat Bill Payment System, which is a national interoperable system for bill payment. So all bills will flow through this: electricity bill, water bills, insurance premiums. So massive conversion of payment that you made by check and now becoming electronic payments using the Bharat Bill Pay. So fundamentally, all these reforms of the last several years are all culminating in the massive digitization of the financial system, and it has implications that I'll come to. And many more systems are coming. I mentioned the Bharat Bill Payment System, which will be transacting about a billion bills a month, you know, utility bills and so on. And another important thing, of course, subject to the law being passed, is the Goods and Service Tax Network. And this was something which I had worked on when I was in the government. So now there's a single backbone for this called the Goods and Service Tax Network. It's a company which will process every GST tax in the country. So that will be processing about 5 billion invoices every month. So you think about it. Suddenly all these things are falling into place, and massive electronification and digitization of things that were paper for decades and centuries. And this is also leading to new age platform, where people are using all this technology to create applications. E-commerce, we are very familiar with Amazon, Snapdeal, Myntra, and so on. But healthcare, there's a very successful company called Practo, which has millions of doctors and millions of consumers using their healthcare platform. Of course, transportation, we know what's happening with Ola and Uber and so on. Hotels, OYO, Stayzilla. Stayzilla is actually a very successful aggregation product which aggregates stays at religious places for people who go to on pilgrimage. It's a very, very successful. Nobody's heard of it, but it's extremely successful. Then, of course, classifieds. Then you have Portia for healthcare. You know, so the, everywhere you see that people are now saying, how do we use the power of this new technology to create these kind of digital platforms? And these are increasingly becoming bigger and bigger. Today, you know, between Ola and Uber, they would be doing about 300 to 400,000 cars across the country. So these are all, they're not small, they're actually becoming important and doing lots of transactions. And because of this, because of the platforms are now making their transactions with their partners digital. It's important to realize. So when, suppose I become an Ola driver and I do 10 Ola trips a day, then there's a digital track or digital trail of that activity because that booking is all done through my smartphone. Or if I'm a vendor and I provide some product that is sold on Amazon, then everything that I sell is sold through a digital interface. So around these platforms, you're going to find that everybody else will also get, will be forced to digitize. So the digitization will not only be in the platform, it will also be among the vendors, the service providers, the product, everybody will do that. And this is going to create massive amounts of data. And I'll come back to why this is important. So this is, so it's actually going to happen all over the place. The smartphone will do it, these platforms will do it, government programs will do it. You know, for example, you know, the most famous government program is the DBT, the direct benefit transfer for, it began with LPG, as you know, and it's now going on to other. This has already done 1 billion transactions. 100 crore transactions have happened since inception, amounting to about 30,000-40,000 crores. It's a very, very serious, you know, this is not small, this is a big transaction. In fact, the DBTL was led by a guy from the Tamil Nadu cadre, Neeraj Mittal. So you have to thank the IAS of Tamil Nadu for that. So I think all these platforms are going to lead to massive digitization. And what this means, and we must understand the implication of this, that India will go from data poor to data rich very, very fast, at a speed that you cannot imagine. You know, you may say GDP growing at 7%, nominal GDP at 13%, population at 1%, whatever, but this is going to grow at 1000%. So suddenly India is going to go from being data poor to data rich. And that data rich is the heart of the change that is going to happen. And what's happening, and that's going to happen from social, there are 100 million people on WhatsApp, Facebook, commerce, there's, you know, 50 million people buying on Amazon and Flipkart, payments to all the digital payments, paperless processes, identity, all these things are going to create a tsunami of data. So that's going to happen on the data side. But that is in turn is meeting a very important thing, which is the algorithms to work on this. And as you know, the most exciting area today is what's called as machine learning or artificial intelligence, where algorithms are learning from data as to what to do. Already the algorithms for face recognition are better than any human being's ability to, you know, recognize faces. You already seen that Watson beat everyone at chess, and now AlphaGo beat everybody at Go, which is this other game. So increasingly algorithms are meeting data. So on one hand, the algorithms or these very sophisticated neural networks are able to operate, and on the other hand, there's this massive flood of data which is coming. So both are coming together, and this synthesis of data and algorithms will fundamentally change the way that we do many businesses, and that's something which you're going to see in India very rapidly in the coming years. Now, why do I argue that it'll be domestic consumption led, not exports? I'll give you a few data points on that. Clearly, we are seeing Jeff Immelt, the CEO of General Electric, the ultimate globalization company, says that globalization has been attacked like never before. Protectionism is going around the country. We don't need to. And trade deals are slowing down. The WTO has not done a deal in a decade. The TPP is stuck. The Transatlantic Partnership is stuck. Everywhere, things are getting stuck. So Donald Trump goes to Scotland and says that, thanks for voting to go out. Actually, the Scots didn't vote to go out. But anyway, don't expect Trump to have details correct. And you know, you all know what happened in Brexit. You have leaders Le Pen. Trump in his acceptance speech says, we'll get out of NATO, we'll get out of WTO, we'll build a wall. So fundamentally, all over the world, we are seeing a backlash about globalization, and people are pulling up, creating barriers. So this is a trend everywhere. But this is actually causing on-the-ground issues. Global trade is slowing down. This is the value of global trade in the last several quarters systematically going down. So clearly, it's not just, you know, statements. It's actually impacting trade on the ground. There's something called the Baltic Dry Index, which is an index that tells you the price of booking freight. It is at its lowest. So today, actually, if you're relocating, it's a good time because you get very good rates on freight. So freights are growing down. That's, again, another proxy for the economy, global trade slowing down. And Indian exports are trending down. If you look at the last 17 months' data, Indian exports are trending down. So whatever way you look at data, it's coming to the same conclusion that the pace of globalization is reversing. Now, obviously, it doesn't mean globalization is going to stop. India went from 15% of GDP, trade to GDP ratio from 15% to 50%. But my point is, it's not going to go from 50 to 70. It's going to, you know, now it's sort of peak. And therefore, you can think of globalization slowing down. Whereas, on the other hand, domestic consumption in India continues to grow. So even as the export numbers are slowing down, domestic consumption is going up. And therefore, one could argue that the future is actually to use domestic consumption to drive growth and not export. Now, nobody is saying exports are going to stop. I'm just saying, what is the demand driver in the system? The demand driver in the system is not going to be exports. It's going to be domestic-led. That's argument number one. Let me come to the second thing. Why it will be services-led and not manufacturing? Because, again, the classic belief is manufacturing. Now, India is the only country in an aging world. From 2015 onwards, thanks to the one-child policy, China's already started aging. And therefore, all over the world, they'll need Indians to do something. There's no choice. Either they will go there physically, in which case they'll have to migrate, or they'll do it over the wire using outsourcing. One of the two. So that's all services. And everything in the growth, whether it's housing, health, education, is all services. And the good news about services, they don't need as much capital as manufacturing. And therefore, you know, for every rupee, you'll get more growth. And there are lots and lots of service possibilities that you have. And we think that services will grow. This is a data which I got from Mint, which is RBI source. You'll see that manufacturing grew at 9.5%. Services grew at 15.5%. So the data is showing clearly that services growth is much faster than manufacturing growth, and that's a trend everywhere. And services like tourism have enormous potential. You know, number of people coming to India is just 8 million. People coming to Thailand is 25 million. So clearly there's something we need to do about that, right? But the other thing which is happening, what's that?
Tamil Nadu is the number one tourist destination.
Intellectual capital, tourism destination. You have everything you want, yeah? So the other thing is, how manufacturing is changing. I think people are underestimating the level of automation happening in manufacturing today. Automation through 3D printing or robotics or Internet of Things or this, that, and the other. And manufacturing is becoming a high-end, high capital intensive activity, creating very few jobs. It's not like the old days. Today, Foxconn, famous here, Nokia, Foxconn is looking at building an iPhone factory in California, entirely using robots. They don't need people. If you go to the gigafactory of Tesla in Nevada, it's the world's largest battery factory with just a few thousand employees. Adidas, the German company Adidas, is looking at making shoes in Germany. Think about it. These guys were, you know, importing shoes from making it in China, Korea, whatever. Shoes are being made in Germany. It's all robotic and it's all customer of one. It's customized to each person. They're able to do that today. So fundamentally, the manufacturing revolution led by technology is going to make it actually is reducing the labor content, so jobs are not getting created, and this is now making it viable to actually move production back to the West. And you're seeing that with Tesla, with Foxconn, with Adidas. It's happening in every industry. The other thing is, when China, Korea, Japan started the journey of industrialization, They had universal literacy. Everybody was educated. They could come to a factory and they could read instructions. How do you do this without literacy? How do you do that without addressing, how without people being able to read or write? How do they work and read instructions, right? And when China started its growth, there was no other China. Think about it. Today, China's steel capacity is 822 million tons. Actually, their installed capacity is 1.2 billion. They're producing 822 million. India is just 1/10, 86 million. If the Chinese want, they can just dump steel here, and with the depreciating currency, it'll just, the only way, therefore, then you go to government, they put some minimum import price, all that stuff. But you can't do this in every sector. You can't say we put barriers on import. So fundamentally, if you really want a free market, very lot of Indian industry is going to get affected, because China is a massive overproducer, massive overcapacity, and no place to consume. They'll dump it around the world. And therefore, trying to copy them now when they have all the capacity is not a great idea, right? And one great proxy is taxes. If you recollect, again, you were part of all that, the Chalaya Committee report, which came out with the idea of service tax, and service tax was implemented in the 90s. And I think that time states didn't know what was the service tax, so the center got to keep all of it. Service tax growth, that's the orange line, has almost caught up with excise. So from zero, because service tax came only in 94-95, service taxes are almost touching excise duties. Which means that this is again a proxy for the way the service industry in India is growing, as more and more things have service tax. And then, so that's very clearly shows that India's growth is really going to come from services. I mean, you may talk all you want about Make in India and all that, but fundamentally it's going to come from services. And let me come to the final point, which is small business led, not large employees. So I talked about the platformization. So instead of having companies that have thousands and thousands of employees, you'll have platforms which have few employees but will act as aggregators of other partners, right? So it's basically a company using a tech platform and aggregating a lot of people. And these partners will provide payment services, logistics services, they'll use data, there'll be few of them, but they'll have few employees, but they'll grow the market. And these platforms will have, they in turn will use platforms. Somebody will have an accounting platform. Somebody will have a logistics platform. All that will start happening. Look at Uber. Uber has only 6,500 employees globally. They have 1.5 million cars and drivers on their platform. So that is the multiplier that they create. Only 6,500 employees inside, but 1.5 million drivers around the world. And this tells you, for example, Practo has 5,000 employees, 200,000 doctors. Paytm has 4,500 employees, 100,000 merchants. Flipkart has 23,000 employees, 100,000 merchants. So essentially, the platformization of these economies will create platforms with a fewer number of employees, but their magnification happens because on that platform, there are vendors, there are drivers, there are doctors, there are farmers, there are retailers. So this is how the job creation will happen. Job creation will not happen inside large firms, but platforms, amplification through technology, and bringing all these guys together. So this means that platforms will bring in new efficiencies because they will get more business. Platforms will be able to procure at lower cost, so they'll aggregate the demand of all the things. They'll be able to get better customer service. And so the job creation, therefore, will happen at the edge of the platform. It won't happen inside a firm. It'll happen at the edge of the platform. And for that, you need a different approach to skilling. You need portability of skills. You need certification. You need to think of it very differently because people are going to be moving around. And you require, and why skilling is important is because once a person is on a platform, then that person represents the brand of the platform, right? So if you have an incident with a driver, and something goes wrong, you blame the driver. If you have an incident with an Uber driver, you blame Uber. The moment you have a branded platform, the brand responsibility comes on the platform, and the platform has to make sure that the person working on the platform meets certain standards. So when the delivery boy from Amazon or Flipkart comes home, you want him to, you know, conduct his customer service in a particular way. So platforms also force better quality skilling on the edge of the platform. Correct? Right? And it also means that the way we think of social security net has to fundamentally change. You know, if you look at the design of the Employees Provident Fund, EPFO, for a long time you couldn't move your account. Right? So every time I change my job, I got a new EPFO number, because it was not designed for an era where people change jobs. It was designed for an era where you joined an HMT at 25 and retired at 65. So that game is over. People are going to be in this. Everybody is an entrepreneur. Everybody is. So you need to provide a net where people can do savings, healthcare, skills, education, pensions, all in a highly portable manner. I should be able to go somewhere, change my things. So, you know, you have to completely redesign the way you think of social security. And these new age platforms are very important. They will solve local problems, they'll create value, and they'll create jobs. In other words, job creation will happen not from large companies hiring thousands of people, but platforms enabling thousands of people. So this is fundamentally the thing, that these three things. Now, why is India particularly in a good place to take advantage of this? One is that India is the only large region which is a single market for services with a free movement of labor. And we don't really internalize this. In India, whether it's banking is a national regulator, RBI, telecom national regulator, TRAI, insurance national regulator, IRDA, pension national regulator, PFRDA. So everything, so we have a common thing. In the United States, if you launch an insurance product, you have to get approval from 50 regulators. Do you know that? If you launch a mortgage, you have to get approval from 50 states. So they don't have a single market for services. Same thing in Europe, you have to go to every country and get permission. China has a single market, but no free movement of labor. You want to move from, you know, Western province to Pudong, you've got to, you know, get that Haku, whatever, that permit. So India has the advantage that we have a fragmented market for products, GST and all that yet to come. We have a local market for agriculture. You have to sell to the local APMs. You can't even sell next door. But we have a national market for services. So that is the reason why services is only national market, which is why it's growing faster, because of the liquidity of a national market with free movement of labor. So both of them are coming together to create this growth. Now, in this, we have something called the India Stack, which is public infrastructure for doing this. Aadhaar, I told you, is 1 billion people, but also ability to authenticate online. I can check whether the person is the person he claims to be. And so basically, it removes physical presence. I can sit in my house watching TV and, you know, open a bank account by pressing on my phone. That's where we're headed. And then you have the KYC, which allows you to open a bank account. Many, many banks now, you just go with your Aadhaar number, do a KYC, your bank account is open. So that makes the whole thing paperless and instant. There's something called e-sign, which allows you to sign a document. So example, you apply for a loan on your phone, you can sign it with Aadhaar and you don't need paper. It's paperless. So all documents can become paperless, and those documents can be stored in a paperless manner. All this has been built by the government of India. Please understand, all this has been built by the government of India. And then I mentioned to you UPI, which is a platform for payments, which is getting launched in the next 3 to 4 days. And it's really pretty advanced. You can push money, pull money, you can, you know, it's just too many features, but it's all like very much, and no other country in the world has this stuff. And then we have something called electronic consent, which allows you to use your data for your benefits. You want to get a loan, you can say, get me my bank statement, I'll give it to the lender to get loans. And that allows you to give loans very quickly. There is misuse. In fact, there's a recent report by Credit Suisse that says that the Indian lending market is going to grow 5 times in the next 10 years and creating $600 billion of new market cap. You know, that's the scale of what is possible here. So this is all. So all this does is, you know, it makes authentication, you can do anywhere. Everything is paperless, everything is cashless, and you can give consent. And all this is based on the fact that a billion people will have Aadhaar, billion people have phones, billion people will have bank accounts. So fundamentally, you are driving a change through digital technology. And this is how all this evolved in the last 10 years from 06 to, I mean, till 16. So this is not built in a day, it was built over many years. And we think this is a genuine disruption because this does to services what industrial revolution did to manufacturing. The industrial revolution took manufacturing and made it automated, brought in steam engines, brought in scale, brought in weaving machines. So productivity went up in manufacturing. What this does, it brings productivity into services because you're able to actually do services in a structured manner. You know, Coase's law, it reduces interaction cost, you know, search cost, coordination cost, etc. So fundamentally, it and does this at a very big way. So the ability to make industrializing services actually the way the services revolution is going to happen. And I'll give you four examples. Banking will be completely reimagined. You can do completely banking on the phone. I don't need a branch. I don't need an ATM. I don't need nothing. And everything we can do on the phone. We can do capital markets on the phone. So SEBI is now launching mutual funds with one click on your phone. And they dramatically lower the cost of acquisition and dramatically expand the market. So more and more people can buy mutual funds on the phone. Credit at scale, now I can borrow on the phone and I can use my data to get a loan. Think about it. India will go, today India is a prepaid society, right? No credits, you have to pay in advance. You want 10 minutes of talk time, you first pay 10 rupees and then you get 10, you know, time. So India will go from prepaid to postpaid because people can now get credit. So the economic activity of prepaid to postpaid will generate huge amount of this thing. And then of course skilling also will happen through platforms using all these things. And when you're able to provide skilling at an individual level and you're able to carry your skill data with you to a job and that's verifiable, then you have a monetary value for your skills. Today there is no value, I don't know whether this carpenter is a good or a bad guy, so I pay the same amount. The moment your skills are able to be monetized, then people's skills will improve. So there will be a whole skill game that happens. So fundamentally, our thesis is that using this Jandhan Aadhaar mobile, you're going to have lots of new applications that will come. And it will, for example, today the government is using Aadhaar for subsidy reform and DBT and attendance. And then now the banking system is using Aadhaar for KYC. But ultimately, there will be a large innovation economy that uses this infrastructure to create a high trust network. Because today India is a low trust society. I can't verify this guy. Now we can verify real identity. You can build high trust network. You can build credit histories. All that will start changing. And we think that that will lead to what we call as the acceleration of formalization. So India is an informal society that will become formal as more and more people enter the formal society. And they are able to then reduce the friction to join the system. And when you reduce friction and enable credit, it is better to be inside than outside. Today, it's better to be outside than inside. Not worth it being inside the system. But tomorrow, if you're able to leverage data and get loans and other things for people, they'd rather be in the system. This, we think, will drive a very massive formalization of the economy, which will drive a lot of economic growth. So I think we are looking at, you know, a cycle of growth, but it's not going to be large company, NPA, bank, none of that stuff. It's going to be driven by millions of small guys using latest technology to reduce transaction costs and become part of the formal economy. This is what we're saying. Domestic consumption-led, not exports. Services-led, not manufacturing. Small business-led, not large employers. And leveraging a technology that only India has. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank you, Nandan. That was a very exciting journey we all went through. I think we'll take some few questions. We're still very much in time. Can you pass on the mic there, please?
We'll answer the questions.
Yeah, just a second. We're just getting the mic to you, please.
You hear me? Yeah, my name is Suresh. So thank you very much for an excellent presentation. This was a real eye opener. I've two things which you had mentioned. One is that the growth be domestic. I think that's a very significant point. The second thing you said is that the whole growth is going to come from millions of small people. And the third thing, it's going to be driven by the platform,
and the digital platform.
Can I have the question?
Yeah. I'll come to the question. The question is that if it's going to become such a big digital world, and in businesses, now if all of us are going to get connected, do you think we are moving towards a barter kind of an economy where I don't need cash? So I have an exchange where I keep, all millions of us keep servicing each other, then the requirement for the whole cash comes down?
No, I mean, what will happen is that you'll go towards cashless.
Yeah, so completely.
The digitization will lead to less cash in the economy, and cash in India is a very expensive business.
Yeah.
See, today, for example, when you do a DBT into somebody's account, it's already coming cashless, it's coming to an account. Tomorrow, when merchants start accepting payments from your phone, then you don't have to pay cash. The key is to get small merchants to accept payments from your phone and not by cash. And the reason why the merchant will accept payments using a phone is that the digital trail of that will allow him to borrow money. It's all related. You're creating an incentive structure which will encourage people to join the formal economy.
Because in Switzerland, now I think it's about close to 50% where the barter economy has taken over from the regular economy.
No, barter, I mean, barter ultimately is setting value, and it could be electronic.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. That was wonderful. Kaushik from Chennai. I work on the advisory for Zora and Atlassian. So, So I have understood how disruption works. Now, you mentioned goods, products, services. That was a very interesting slide. How do you see regulation changing to affect this? Because the government of India rolled out a lot of new things, but I guess they were not so impacted by regulation as much as the standard economy is going to be.
So I think the areas where the regulator is national, I think there's a fair amount of activity. For example, today RBI is at the forefront of regulation to deal with payments, payment banks, small banks, UPI and all that. Even SEBI is revamping its regulation to make everything paperless and cashless. CRAI. So I think when it's a national regulator, I think there is a, but when it's a state-by-state regulation like in the taxi business, then it's going to be more complicated because it will be a state-level regulator and there are also political forces at play and so on. So I think it will be messier in activities which have a, you know, a state-by-state approach. But where there's a federal regulator, and we're very lucky that India has a national regulator for banking, telecom, insurance, pensions and so on, and capital markets, it will be much better.
Now even real estate is coming.
Real estate, I don't know. You cannot. I'm not trying to solve real estate.
No, I know
that. Hi, Ramadas from the Chennai Mathematics Institute. If platforms are going to be so important, do you think the government should favor domestic platforms, Flipkart instead of Amazon, and Ola instead of Uber?
No, that's a broad, larger debate as to what is the level of protection that you want to give domestic companies, right? I mean, we had this whole debate, and then in 91 we liberalized and said we want to be open and all that. Now the Chinese on technology went very differently. The Chinese essentially created a wall to and let their domestic players. So instead of Google, Facebook and Amazon, you have Baidu, Alibaba and Tencent. And there's a company called Didi which is giving Uber a run for the money. So they have chosen to build domestic champions by actually preventing the American companies. This is a policy decision that, I don't want to comment whether you want to do that or not, because there are pros and cons of both approaches. But you're right. India is a unique market in the internet economy because it's the only market. The Americans are there, the Chinese are there, and Indian entrepreneurs are there. Because America doesn't have the Chinese companies, China doesn't have the America. We have all three. Because you have Amazon coming here, you have Alibaba coming, you have Flipkart here. So it's actually a very, very hyper-competitive market, and whether we should, that's really a bigger decision I want to comment.
Yeah, I think we'll pass on the mic there. Oh, okay. After that, please.
Srinath from Great Lake.
Srinath from Great Lake. Yeah, go ahead.
I just have a small question regarding Aadhaar, because you are the pioneer, started the whole initiative. Is it a good question to ask? I'm not sure. because it's a very good concept, but the implementation lacks a lot of punch. It's not an equivalent of SSI, the Social Security Index of US.
I think I beg to disagree, but anyway.
Yeah.
So, are there any future plans or is
no, no. What is it that is lacking that you found?
The implementation of Aadhaar has a lot of difficulty, and many of the parts are not fully covered.
Look, I don't want to get into the politics of what happened with Aadhaar.
Yeah.
Home ministry,
I think let's not
that.
Have this as a platform.
Yeah, okay.
But at the end of the day, billion people have it.
Nandan? Yeah, okay. Just a second. We have one here. Ma'am? Yeah, go ahead.
You talked about merchant digital acceptance. How would you tackle that problem? What would be the first thing you would think through to go about it?
Merchant
acceptance. Acceptance, yeah.
Actually, what's going to happen is in the next few months, once this unified payment interface comes, more and more people will have on their phone a way to make a proximity payment, a payment to a merchant either through various methods. You can do it through NFC or you can just hold it there or whatever, or QR codes. There are many ways to do that. And more providers of POS devices, mobile POS devices, will make their device ready for that. For example, EasyTap. Mrs. EasyTap is here. So I think that's how it will happen. See, the thing is like this. What is the incentive for the transaction to go cashless? The first is that transaction cost has to go to zero. Because when I pay cash, if I pay somebody 500 rupees, he gets 500 rupees. If I pay with a credit card, these guys deduct some 2%, 3%. I don't know. But I think once you have the mobile-to-mobile payment, those guys will do it and eat the transaction cost. Because the data is more valuable to them than the transaction cost. So you're going to have players in the game in the next 6 months who will offer same value. You pay digitally 1,000 rupees, it gets 1,000. So you removed one friction, which is the transaction fee. And the second thing is that more and more people will start lending to the retailer using the digital footprint. And then that's an incentive for him to take digital payment. So the incentive for the consumer is no fees. The incentive for the merchant is that he can use that data to get credit. So these kind of incentives will have to be aligned for this to take off.
Can I ask one small question? So you mentioned that DBT is transferred into bank account. So everywhere, even the poor will get their cash. Bank account, then digital cash. So how do you make that population transact digitally? What would be your perception of bringing them on board? Because that's how a success to your story.
The first thing is that it should be easy for them to pull out cash from their account. Which is why a BC network is so important, because I should have the confidence that when I want physical cash, I can pull it out. And then once I make these merchant payments cashless, then instead of going to the merchant, removing cash and paying with cash, I'll just pay him electronically from my phone. So that's how it will change.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, go ahead, on top.
My name is Hema. I'm from the Madras School of Economics. And my question is, while this wonderful transformation is going to impact the services sector, by bringing transparency and inclusion, how long will it be before it can reform things in the government sector, bringing in more transparency and reducing corruption? Because ultimately, it has to transfer to that segment also. But what is your prediction, given the state center kind of issues that he was also talking about?
No, I think, there's retail corruption and wholesale corruption. I don't know which one you are referring to. Wholesale corruption, I'll refer to my esteemed colleague Mr. Narayanan, Mr. Raghavan, Gopalswamy, tell us. But retail corruption is when you have to pay money at the point of getting a service or benefit and you have to pay something, right? That will start going away with all this. Because today, what happens in government public services is that you can only get your food or money from one person. And when there's only one service provider, the negotiating power is with the service provider, right? But now, once you use identity on the cloud, I can go to any service provider to withdraw.
So the bargaining power shifts to the beneficiary. For example, in Andhra Pradesh now 29,000 PDS outlets are online, and if I am a PDS recipient in Andhra Pradesh, I can go to any one of them to get my rice. Then there is no corruption, because if some guy acts funny, I will go to somebody else. So you have to change the bargaining power at the point of service. So that will happen. Wholesale corruption is a different.
Ma'am, that we can discuss offline. Yeah, Ranjini, please go ahead.
So I'm Ranjini from Global Adjustments. You came up with three ideas here: people, products, and platform. I see a lot of innovation in product and platform. I'm interested to hear from you, what are we doing as innovation in skill building in our people, or what should we be doing?
No, I think, as I mentioned, when you platformize, the platform brand promise is based on the quality of the people on the platform, right? So suppose I'm running, I have 200,000 drivers on my platform, and I'm one of these large firms, then the brand promise is how that driver conducts himself when you go into his car. And that forces the platform guys now to work on making the edge of the platform higher quality. So I think the skilling will happen from platform outside. Similarly, if I'm a delivery boy for somebody, I want to make sure that he speaks well, he's polite, you know, all that. So I think that will drive the whole thing. The platform, in their own self-interest, will have to make sure the edge is high quality.
You'll have to do an ILI instead of Aadhaar now.
Yeah, go ahead.
Mic's not working.
No, it was working.
This boy here, my technology consultant. I agree with all the issues of the platform part of the thing. Would there be an initiative by the government to open up data? So what about data.gov being put up in public domain? The government owns a lot of data, and it probably keeps a very strong, it's all on closed walls, right? Are developers, application people to kind of take it down to the next level of government to citizen, government to business interaction, and creating more apps? Will the government be open to opening up the data itself?
I'm not a spokesman for the government.
No, what would force the government, or what would persuade the government? You talk about incentives for the...
Technically, there's no problem, because, data is RTI-able. And technically, all that data should be in the public domain. And Section 4 of RTI says that should proactively build systems and publish data. There's no legal or technical issue. It's really, there's no incentive to make it transparent. I mean, there's some group, some assorted groups have made the data transparent, but not as a system, because there's no upside to do it for the guys inside.
Yeah, that's just come up. Go ahead.
Sir, I'm Skandan, I'm from the government. I want to ask you one question. There is a book called The Second Machine Age recently, which talks more or less what you just said. But in that book, it's very pessimistic. It ends with a lot of inequality and less jobs, less employment. You have given a very positive picture, which is very good, but you have not told us what is the downside.
Yeah.
When it will not happen.
No, lots of downside. But you want to start CIC, no? You wanted me to start.
Actually, it was good news for us, because I was looking that maybe finally Achay didn't have come.
No, I think what's happening in the West is you're going to see a hollowing out of the middle class jobs. For example, if self-driving cars and self-driving trucks come in 10 years, you won't need anyone to drive a truck on a US highway. So those kind of things. And so definitely, I think it's a challenge in the West. I think our thing is different, partly because per capita incomes are lower, and therefore the replacement of technology will not happen that fast, because prices will have to really crash. And I think the what we are talking about, creating a services capability, because what we have in India, nobody else has, the ability to do paperless transactions, cashless transactions, at a low cost. Nobody has that. That digital infrastructure doesn't exist. So I think we are in a better wicket because we have urbanization that is not yet done. Literacy is not done. So there are many low-hanging fruit. You can think of them as low-hanging fruit.
Yeah. We have three questions to go. Yeah.
So I'm Nixon Fernando from Great Lakes Institute of Management. In your book, you have talked about urbanization as being the expected thing in the future. In contrast to that, we have the Pura model, which comes from Dr. Kalam and Dr. Inaugration. So I just want to know, in the context of what you were saying just now, in terms of services taking over, in terms of platforms taking over, do you think that position will change, or we'll move towards more towards the Pura?
No, I think there are some services that will benefit from aggregation of people in a place. But other services, for example, e-commerce, now will be able to offer the same products in a village as in a city. So that will be more like the Pura thing. I think both will happen.
Yeah, go ahead.
Good evening. Thank you very much for that wonderful talk. Two trends. On the one hand, we talk of increased employment. But when we talk of employment, we tend to talk of skills. We talk of the taxi drivers. We talk of delivery boys, shopkeepers, and so on. On the other hand, there seems to be a tapering off of the jobs boom in the IT sector itself due to increased automation of basic processes and so on. Given this, what would you say is the role of education in this whole mix?
Big question, yeah?
Yeah.
No, I think the education will have to be lifelong and agile, because jobs will change, skills will change, knowledge will change. So I think rather than trying to prescribe what education is, really, how do you create a flexible architecture where people are continuously able to keep educated? And in that sense, instead of you going to the learning must come to you. And that's where technology will play a role. So I think that's a whole different, big discussion by itself. But I think there is a dramatic change that will happen, I think, in education.
Excuse me. Yeah, go ahead. Can't hear.
You're talking about the sweet spot being MSME and services, if I'm correct. Now you're entering the realm which is the sweet spot of black money today. And they are, when I see that slide saying you're going to build huge data trails, we play in that space, and we find for us to grow our business, that's one of the biggest impediments, this black money and this data trail that is there. How do you see, do you have any suggestions to overcome that?
No, that's the point I was making, that the application that will drive people entering the formal economy is going to be the provisioning of affordable credit using data. Because if that is so, then the person will decide that it's worth it being inside the system and paying taxes because I can get a loan at 15% instead of 50%. So you have to create a structure where it is inconvenient to stay out and beneficial to stay in. Today the thing is opposite. So I think that is a switch which will happen. For example, you take GST, right? When GST comes, everyone will have to be in the tax chain, because if I have to take a credit from my vendor, he has to have paid his taxes. So the daisy chain of GST, for example, will force people to pay taxes. There are many things. Part of it is the administrative thing. Part of it is incentives. It just makes more. It will make more sense for a person to be inside the system, because he'll be able to get credit, grow his company, which he can't do today.
If I can just add a follow-up question to that, you'll be really stepping on some very powerful toes in backlash.
Stepping on any toes. What toes?
No, sorry.
Which toes?
Okay.
Can I ask last?
Yeah.
Excuse me. Can I just on your left? Question on the UPI. When the innovation that we expect to happen and the diffusion could be as good as other, what is the role of payment gateways and to some extent wallets if the transaction can happen without a friction?
I think this is going to remove inefficiencies in payment. So if your model is just providing, you know, making transaction fees from payments, then you need to rethink your business. On the wallet side, wallets are not part of the initial UPI thing. So people may use wallets with bank accounts. The wallets become like temporary holding accounts, bank accounts become the place where you take the money from. So they'll actually, because one thing is that wallets are very cheap. In the sense, the transaction cost of a wallet is very low. Because when you look at how wallets are used from, say, Paytm or MobiQuick, the biggest use case is stuff like recharge. The average recharge is only 30 rupees. So they learned how to do high volume, low cost transactions, and banks don't do that well. So I think there's a sort of a play where you'll use both. I'll use the wallet for small value payments. You know, I'm not clear how it'll all evolve, but I think they'll figure out a role.
Thank you. Any last question? Yeah. Or you have also? Okay. Let's make it short. I like to have a question.
My name is Raman. I'm a lawyer. We are, speaking for myself, I'm very optimistic about these things, but we are a country known for making a scam out of everything. What you've spoken about involves a lot of relationships between people, invisible relationships between people. We are still a country where when we go to Thailand, we are afraid to take out our credit card. Because by the time we come back, Standard Chartered or somebody says, did you use it there? Then you're banking it out. With this kind of distrust, don't you think you need to also, more than educating that people, you need to educate the actual consumers that this is all going to be very consumer safe, because a lot of hesitancy may be there for people to get into a transaction which is completely invisible, because traditionally we Indians believe in face to face.
Yeah, but actually the security here is stronger than in the card world. Many of the issues that you face, for example, you don't share your number. The authenticate approval is done on your phone. You don't even give anybody a card. So all approvals you do on your own. There are many, many features that make it actually safer. But we'll have to see how. Look at this way. Indians are doing millions of prepaid recharges every day. They are giving cash to some grocery store in the middle of nowhere and is giving you stock tank. So they understood that there's a way to do that, and so I think it'll happen.
Yeah, go ahead. Yes, please.
You don't need a mic, huh?
No, I think that'll record the transaction.
Hello. I'm next. Actually. You mentioned the group. Mission. So, do you think the purchasing power of the Indian consumer has really gone up? Purchasing power of the economy, because that happen, you know.
Yeah. So, I mean, I think.
I just have one more question. That is, what do you think? Whatever vision you have outlined, what can derail this vision? Like, you know, infrastructure, for example, power. We still are power. Roadways are being built by this government, but you know, even that infrastructure area is quite weak. So, I mean, these are the two questions I had.
No, lots of things can derail. No, but the point is that I'm making a case that you need to rethink how growth is going to happen. That the old model of relying on exports, relying on manufacturing, relying on large companies may not be tenable anymore. That you need to think about small companies, platforms, you need to think about services, not manufacturing in domestic. And that the technological infrastructure we have in India is unique. Nobody else has this, so we need to leverage that to drive growth. That's my basic thesis.
Yes, ma'am.
Hello, sir. Regina Gurung from the New Indian Express. I just have one really short question. How did you come about this conclusion?
Yeah.
No, I mean, whatever conclusion I have come to, I have tried to back it with data. I have tried to show trends, data, so on. No, it's just that I've been mulling over this and, you know, it all came together.
Yeah, your last question.
compromising on security, national security, privacy, those kinds of things by this digital world?
No, yeah, if you don't do it properly, yes. I mean, in the sense that the more you go digital, the more vulnerable you are to a digital cyber attack and so on. So obviously, whatever you build will have to build the appropriate infrastructure for that. If you don't do it properly, absolutely, that is true.
Isn't that the reason China has developed its own Google, all those products?
No, they say that one of the reasons that the Chinese did it was after the Snowden affair. And they realized that, you know, data was going to Western governments from the East. That's a theory. I don't know. It's possible, but I think that was one of the concerns.
So you take it that we are at a point of inflection?
Yeah, yeah, totally.
Great. That's great news for all of us. Now with this, the session ends. So now I invite Lakshminarayan to please come and propose a vote of thanks. Give a big hand.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Prakash. First of all, I must thank Prakash for handling this question and answer session and also the entire session this evening flawlessly. Thank you very much. And of course, based on the Q&A that we had, I can very precisely say that Nandan has provoked the thought process in all of us. He very passionately argued. In fact, he cried hoarse. He had two or three glasses of water, making a pitch about the new world, a contrarian view, which is terrific, which is what this CIC is all about. Essentially, to get eminent people with different ideas, with contrarian views, that they can share with us, that can be challenged, that can be validated, so that spurs some of us into action to take us into the new world. And when we started this, while it is a Chennai-centric center, we said when we want speakers, we should not restrict ourselves only to this geography. And I must mention a special word of thanks to Ravi Chandra. He delivered a great lecture. You delivered a great person. Thank you very much. And thank you for all those participants who asked those very interesting questions. All right, I've been reminded about a few more thanks that I have to give. Thanks to those people who participated, but most importantly, thank you to all of you for coming here in large numbers. We never expected. We simply did not expect as many people as have assembled today here. In fact, the invitation that we sent out was only to about 230 people. We have had a great number of people accepting, and the hospitality of Sundar Ramasamy and Dr. Rangarajan and Madras School of Economics has been great. I wish they had a larger auditorium. We seem to have outgrown this auditorium on day one, but we'll continue to enjoy the hospitality that's been extended by Dr. Rangarajan and figure out a technological way of dealing with a large group of people. The one conclusion that I came to after the presentation, which I think would be non-controversial, is whatever is the view of the future, current view, established view, contrarian view, alternate view, technology is bang in the middle of all of it. That helps me, that helps Nandan, that helps all of us. Thank you very much, and it remains for me to thank a few people who organized this event. Murali Sweets, Krishna Sweets. Murali and Krishna are synonymous with sweets. And the secretariat of the Chennai International Center, which organized this. Members of the board, people who are upstairs. Venu has been quietly sitting in one corner and watching the proceedings there. He's been running up and down the last few days to put this program together. Thank you, Venu. And thank you, all the other members. Let's break for tea now. Thank you very much.